slide, please. If you're sure you still have trouble, there's a lot of colleges into this. I've got some insights into it that I can share with you that are about 30 years old. I remember sitting in your seats and thinking about how I was going to apply this to my life as a clinician. And I'm going to quote something, not to get you off topic on today's lecture, but I was sitting in the very back of the room, the first day of med school, and someone was, his name was Dr. Austrian. He actually was one of the inventors of some of the early vaccines and systems. And he got up, he said, never forget that half of what you learn in medical school will, by the time you're done, your career has been proven wrong. And I thought, well, yeah, what's the problem here? The problem is you can't tell which half. It's going to save you a lot of time. You'll spend a lot of your careers pushing the envelope of information that you were given, because you're on the cutting edge now. You're being taught things that crazily won't be taught in 10 years. And you won't know about things that in 10 years will be standard for med students. And when I think about what it means to be a physician, remember the word is described in three different languages, right? Physician, physics, from the Greek, you're a scientist. You have to be a doctor, from Latin doctore, teacher. So you've got to educate, which is what we don't do with our patients a lot of times. That 15-minute screening out there fundamentally is about getting people educated about their lives so they appreciate that the temple of the soul is theirs to guard. It's not just giving them numbers. And that's a big insight that I didn't get really too well until both of my practice as a cardiac surgeon. But people do not change what they do based on what they know. They change what they do based on how they feel. So your job is to get them to feel differently about the life that they're living so they can show up with it. And the third word, you've got doctora, physician, and then you have medicine, which means healer. And the healing, and it is an art form that we offer our folks, isn't going to come just for the steel, although we do try to heal with steel. In a surgical specialty, it doesn't come just with the medications we give. I remember operating on a president of a country once, and he said, you know, I know your secret now. You put us on so many medications, we feel poisoned. And every day you take away one of those medications, we feel better. Which is, in fact, what we do after heart surgery, but he was savvy enough to figure it out. So healing really is about connecting to their soul and getting them to appreciate you care for them. Take cigarette smoking as an example. You're all going to have smokers in your practice. Well, you may even have smokers in your family. I hope none of you smokers yourselves. But when you have someone who smokes, and you tell them to stop smoking because it's bad for them, you haven't helped them at all. They already know that. They're mostly trying to stop, but they can't do it. So when you say stop smoking is bad for you, you're underlining it. They're doing something stupid, which makes them feel demeaned. So they get stressed out. So what do? They smoke. They relax. It is their coping mechanism. That's the baggage they're carrying through life. So instead, you could, for example, say, listen, I care about you. I care about you enough that all I'm asking you to do is to care for yourself as much as I care for you. And you, by yourself, stop bothering that body that you live in. That's the reason, as a heart surgeon, I never operate on smokers. It's not because I don't care about them. It's because I care so much about them that I don't want to take them to the operating room and do something to them when my only chance to get them to stop smoking is to deal with it before the procedure. Those are difficult decisions you're all going to have to make in your lives. Now, let me leave you with a couple ideas about what it means to be a professional, because that's what you're really here for. You're getting brought into the culture of professionalism. So a professional always takes care of their client first. By the way, your lawyers are professionals, engineers, there are lots of other professions besides medicine. We're special in some ways, but in this way we're not. We always take care of our client first, which in our case is our patient. Number two, that's the Hippocratic Oath, by the way, which you'll recount when you finish medical school. The second obligation you have as a professional is to recognize you have an obligation to advance the knowledge you're given today. So that slide, which is statically going to exist today, in 2012, some of you are going to advance the information and the insights we have about that image. And that's your job. And we have done that well in medicine. I'm proud of that aspect of what we've done as a profession. The third thing we've got a responsibility to do, we have not done well, which is to police each other. It is our job to make sure that each of us is as safe as we can be, to take care of the people who trust their lives to us. And it starts in medical school. The best predictor of a bad doctor is a physician who's not honorable when they're in medical school. So you will actually have insights. And yes, it's not in our culture, nor do we desire to hurt each other, but you have to hold each other accountable. And so getting up and saying, and getting someone's face, because you have the ability to do, because you care about them, they probably respect that in you, and say, listen, it's not going to work this way. That's not the way you take care of another human being, or that information is not the way you ought to be presenting it. Helping each other do that better is an important obligation. We don't do that well at all. I think that's going to change, and I hope you'll be the generation that leads that change. And the fourth obligation that a professional has, it's the last one, is a civic responsibility to speak out on things you know about. Professionals are the ballast of the troubled ship of society that's going into turbulent waters, especially in today's America. It's imperative that the professional classes, you guys, with me, play a role in that civic discourse. When people want to know about what they should do for healthcare reform or how to get the health back in their communities, or they just want advice about how we can, you know, deal with the stress that we feel in our lives better, we as a class have to be able to step forward and offer that insight. You can do that by going into politics, you can do that by getting involved in public policy discussions, or just talking to the people who you see in your clinics day in and day out, starting pretty soon, but through the rest of your career. So they know where you as a professional stand on things that they have to make decisions about, because they trust us. Our patients trust us a lot. It goes without saying they're trusting us with their lives, but trust us with the decisions they make as well. So we owe them, I think, an obligation to get involved in that. Since you're in the nation's capital, I'll give you one statistic. 10% of people who signed the Declaration of Independence had a medical link of one kind or another. I think 5% were actually doctors. Over the last 100 years, the number of doctors who have gone into that kind of role is less than 0.5%. So we have, I believe, abandoned that obligation that a professional has, and we ought to re-embrace that, re-engage that. And there's no better place to start than today. And that's why that 15-minute clinic is at Howard University. Because with 150 years of serving people in whatever way they need, it's the iconic institution to do a free 15-minute screening. And it's not about charity work. It's very different than that. Listen, it's 3/4 of the people we know from pre-registration already today have insurance. The 25% who don't have insurance, they have jobs. I just saw a woman, Tanya, 42 years old, runs a daycare facility, takes care of 6 kids in her community, doesn't have health insurance because she can't afford it under the current situation. And her triglyceride level was 602. I mean, she's, you know, got an oil stick inside of her vessels. And of course, you know, without insurance, she never got a check. How could she? Never thought about it. But when you add that together with the rest of her numbers, which weren't so good either, you've got a woman who either will have a major catastrophic atherosclerotic problem over the next few years, or she's going to be dealt with, you know, this will be dealt with. One or the other. We can either do it through bypass surgery, or we can do it through, you know, getting to her today. And that's what that's all about out there. So thank you for lending your institution to us, and for a few minutes of the class that I apologize for stealing from you.
No problem.
But I hope it's of value. Now, I know, just a certain amount, it's probably worth me getting in the middle of you somewhere so you can get a class photo. Is that okay? I bunch you already got shots. Maybe I'll get in the middle here somewhere. Is that fair?
Yes.
Take a picture.